Hi, Inigo.
Hi,
So,
hi.
okay, I would say the floor is yours. I don't know if you have a good answer to this question. You can do as you like.
Well, yes, it's a good question. I plan to mention, but well, I can say something now. Basically, we are working with a compiled version of the. I mean, you have the normal benzene program, and you have the option to compile. If you compile the code and you have a relatively recent computer, you can do it in 4 or 5 minutes, the full model until 2050. Okay. Once it is already compiled, if you only modify the external excels, that the data that Luis Javier was mentioning, then it's less than half because you are already running a compiled code. No? So when you are in the developing phase, it's more time consuming. When you just want to use it, let's say, it's fast, much faster. Okay. Okay, so this is, should I start then?
Yeah,
Simone?
Please, Inigo, the floor is yours. So Inigo is really the soul of the model. So
well,
it's people, your responsibility.
Yeah, people make jokes that if one person can understand everything, it should be me. I'm not so sure, but I'm trying. Of course, it's more difficult during the development phase. Then when we will have a final model, it will be much easier for everybody to understand and comprehend everything. So, well, as Simone has presented, my name is Iñigo Capellán, and I am postdoctoral researcher at the University of Valladolid. And my role in the project has been or is being to coordinate all the pieces so we have a final coherent model. Yes. So, well, maybe I should start saying that WILIAM locomotion project was developed as a follow-up project of Medeas. For those of you familiar with the Medeas models, in Medeas project, our team was the responsible for developing the models. And after the project, we wanted to have a project in which we could have a contribution and collaboration from other modelers to develop the or to improve further develop the model. So that's the reason we set up the locomotion consortia with several teams as modelers and splitting the work. So the role of this introduction is basically to explain you the motivation to develop a new model. As Luis Javier has mentioned, there are dozens, if not hundreds, of integrated assessment models out there. So why to develop a new model? And to give you an overview of the main elements of this model and what are the different components that are going to be explained in more detail in the following days. Okay, so, well, I'm going to start with some context, which I believe most of you, if not all, are familiar, but since it is the core motivation for developing our IAM, I would like to at least refresh your minds. So, well, we know that we are in a situation of global environmental sustainability crisis. This planetary boundaries framework that Luis Javier also showed has become quite famous representation of it. And personally, I like because it allows to see the multidimensionality of this crisis. No, even if the most tackled or the most studied issue is climate change with the promotion of renewables and so on, we shouldn't forget that in reality we have several planetary boundaries which have been transgressed: novel entities, biosphere integrity, land system change, water, biogeochemical flows of phosphorus and nitrogen.
Inigo, so, do yes? You want to share your presentation?
I thought I was sharing.
No.
Okay, sorry. Yes, I forgot.
The introduction was so nice, so we didn't realize that was missing. But then I remember the planetary boundaries. So.
Yes, I think everybody. And now you see it?
Yes, perfect.
Okay, so as I was saying, it's very important that when we are trying to solve one problem related to the planetary boundaries, we don't create problems in other dimensions, no? Okay, on the other hand, we are also in a resource crisis, no? So it's well known the problem of the depletion of fossil fuels, even if they are, we need to get rid of them because of the environmental problems. The truth, the reality, the starting point is that we are, especially in rich countries, totally dependent today on fossil fuels because they have very, very good chemical, physical properties, no? But these fossil fuels are subject to depletion, and in some places they are already decreasing. Now, this is a figure of Norway, real data, real oil fields. So a country with a lot of technology, a lot of money, their country and their welfare state depends a lot of oil income, and they are not able to extract more oil. No? So this is because we have geological limits. And this, depending on the metal, is also will be also can be also a problem in the future. No, the difference, of course, is that metals can be recycled and fossil fuels cannot. And then we have, of course, the renewables, which is towards we should transition. And however, here we should take into account that even if the theoretical or geographical potential of renewables are in general very big, when you start to consider realistic constraints and also sustainability constraints, the real techno-sustainable potentials are much lower than it is many times thought. And on the other hand, we have the fact, or the paradox, if you want, that even this depletion of resources and this enormous environmental impacts, we are not even able to cover basic human needs for global population, no? So we have problems in this representation of with life satisfaction, sanitation, income, equality, etc. So with these four elements, is a bit our conceptual map, no? To design a model to try to tackle these issues. Okay, so since sustainability is multidimensional, then we need multidimensional tools for analyzing it. And also I'm here a bit repeating with Luis Javier, but this is very important. And we propose to use integrated assessment models, which basically focus on the connection between human systems. And inside the human system, we have representations of economy, of population, food, technology, etc. So we have the interactions between them and within the natural Earth system part of the models, which include physical things such as climate, oceans, etc. So here the key is really this integration, or if you want in modeling terminology, a hard linking of these different subsystems in a coherent set, where the idea is to see where the current trends take us, and when we identify some issues, then to try to see which policies could be put in place to correct these trends, setting some objectives. All right. So, more explicitly, this is just a graphical example of what I'm trying to say. So, let's say, for example, that we have a model focused on a specific topic, no? Think about an energy model, or an economy model, or a land use model, whatever you are more familiar, no? So in any model, you have some exogenous inputs, which in my example evolve like this, and then you run the model and you get some outputs, which for this example, it also increases. So what happens if we couple this model, a specific topic model, with another model representing another dimension, no? If you do the hard linking, then it becomes integrated, and then if we have two modules of one same model. So then what happens that only with one feedback, you don't need to interact, you don't need to link with many feedbacks, it can already change the behavior of your initial module, no? So introducing this source of information changes totally the behavior of the model. So this is what also was mentioned before about the complex system approach. So the idea is to focus on this interrelationship between different dimensions rather than having a very, very detailed individual module. Well, another way to see it, if we have all these elements in reality, so in a, let's say, energy model, you have a lot of exogenous inputs coming from the other dimensions to the energy model, but then there is not coming back of information from energy to climate, from energy to land use, to energy to economy, whatever. So now I want to give you some examples which show how, if we really want to capture real developments, I mean, developments will happen in real world when we are dealing with sustainability, because we are in this sustainability crisis. We are not anymore in this, in the words of Herman Daly, this empty world, no? In this full world, these interactions are very important. So one first example I would like to give you is that this is now well known, that biofuels can be more carbon intensive than fossil fuels. So this has been, many research has proven this, and the European Commission, for example, has changed their targets in terms of biofuels and their policies according to this, because if you, in this figure you see here the red line, this is the average of fossil fuel greenhouse gases per unit of energy, you can see that in some circumstances, for some biodiesel here in particular, or bioethanol, the life cycle emissions are higher. How is this possible? Basically, because we have this mechanism of indirect land use change, where in the European Union we plant biofuels, it displaces crops, and then we deforest in other parts of the world. No? So it's impossible that an energy module sees this if it is not linked with a land use module. It's impossible. Another example. Renewables are material intensive, no? So there are already research that shows, because photovoltaic, in this example, photovoltaic uses a significant amount of silver, no? So they are already finding relationships between silver prices and solar energy production, no? In fact, our results with Medeas indicate that in that year of the research, maybe 2018, already, oh no, sorry, 2016, already 18% of the total demand of silver global was required by solar PV, no? So it's significant. So how can you see this type of interactions if you don't have a link between energy, materials, and economy? And a third example, which is, I think, also quite famous or quite known, is the rebound effect, no? So we all know that you can achieve some technical efficiency improvements in some specific sectors, transport, buildings, etc. But then, due to the macroeconomic impact or interrelationship of everything, there is a respending effect of this monetary savings due to efficiency, which where we can have rebounds between 50% and 200%. No? So a rebound of 50% means that instead of saving 100 units of energy, at the end we are saving only 50. And if you are over 100%, this is called backfire. And this is that the initial efficiency improvement has triggered, through feedbacks and causal chains, even more energy or emissions consumption than at the beginning. So how can you see this with a full integration of energy and economy? Okay, so these are real things which many models do not capture due to the lack of integration. Okay, so if you overlap the planetary boundaries framework with the basic human needs framework, then you get this donut, which also become quite famous, the donut economics. So the idea conceptually with an IAM, as we interpret it, is that, okay, we have to try to simulate pathways or scenarios which do not transgress the ecological ceiling, that are able to provide well-being, basic needs for everybody. So it will be like going here, traveling in the door of the door. No? So, okay, here there are discussions in the literature, what is the size of this dough, if it is thick or if it's thin, no? There are even people who think there is not enough dough, but this is another discussion. Okay, So here, coming back to some ideas presented by Luis Javier in the introduction, but which I think are very important for the following the MOOC course. So how do we apply the models? Because of course, a model does not produce any result alone. You need to run it with some assumptions, no? So the starting point is a model in which is full of a structural hypothesis and where you have your models interlinked. And then the starting point is always a storyline or a narrative, no? What do you want to simulate? You have to take into account that these type of models are very large. We have now in William something between 50 and 100 policies. So it doesn't make sense to change every policy independently. You need to have a consistent story about how to change all of them. So once you have the storyline, you can build the scenario, which for us is the quantification of the storyline already adapted to the structure of the hypothesis and policies, to the scenario inputs of the model. And then you obtain, you can try two types of storylines. As I mentioned, you have always a baseline scenario in which you try to reproduce the current trends, and then to try to solve the problems, you test different alternative scenarios. Okay, so once you run the model, you get some results. You always need to have in your storylines predefined some goals. You check if you have reached them. If you have not reached them, which it usually happens at the first run, no, with this type of complexities, then you have to rethink your scenario, maybe improve or make strengthen some policies, or maybe you are lacking some things, or maybe you emerge some rebounded effects unexpected, so you understand what is happening. As Simone said, sometimes you find errors. Then you reiterate, and with this iterative process, you hope to find some set of policy recommendations. In the limit, of course, maybe the storyline could be wrong. So this is the most drastic conclusion, but it can happen. Okay, so our models are policy simulation, but this doesn't mean that we can use optimization techniques to identify which set of portfolio of policies and which parametrization can optimize some goals. So this is can be done technically, and we have done some tests during the project. It has some complexity, but it can be done. Okay. So now I would like to enter more specifically into William and to explain what are the main questions that we wanted to address when we developed this model. And like that, we enter a bit into the topic of the novelties. So I'm going to read them. Basically, these are the main questions, and there are many, many sub-questions if you want in each module. So overall questions, which sustainability paradigms and set of policies can help design a sustainable energy transition within the planetary and social boundaries? How can we reach 100% renewables in different countries? This is very important also in the context of IAMS. I will explain later, because many IAMS are just not able or were not able until recently to reach high targets of renewables based on CCS and other speculative technologies. What are the monetary, energy, and material investments or requirements to achieve the transition to zero carbon economies? And also, what are the impacts of the energy transition in different modules, no? Different elements of the society or the nature. For example, the economic structure of different countries, different people in society, income, labor, consumption, well-being, land uses and products, etc. And one last question, which is linked to the first one, no? What are the potential limits to growth that biophysical constraints, for example, energy potential, critical materials, may impose to the economy? Okay, so basically, very summarized, no? Our idea, our objective was to be able to capture socioeconomic implications of the energy transition, taking into account at the same time these biophysical constraints. Another different aspect from other IAMs is that in terms of narratives, we take a pluralistic approach. So this means that, okay, we also analyze green growth and green deal narratives, which are, let's say, dominant from an institutional point of view, but we are also very interested in and post-growth or degrowth narratives that are much, well, that are not mainstream. So in order to include these heterogeneous scenarios, this means that we need to include two types of policies, policies that I have called conventional policies because they are present in almost all models. So you can think about CO2 taxes, recycling of materials, renewable targets, efficiency improvements, etc. But then we need a portfolio of heterogeneous policies. We need, for example, behavioral changes we have for diets and transport. We have basic income, working time reduction, alternative agricultural management practices, not based on fertilizers and so on. And then on the other hand, we have some, let's say, more methodological novelties, which were thought to address some of the key limitations of the integrated assessment field from our point of view. So some of these limitations were already an objective, no, of MEREAS, but here we are still working on them. So this list includes, for example, a often too simplistic representation of the economic processes. Many YAMs have a very stylized economic module, and sometimes even they have something so small that I wouldn't call a module, no? So if you don't have a representation, detailed representation of economy, then the feedback of the rest of the model or the rest of the reality with the economy, then you cannot represent it. Then there are some dimensions that for us are important that are in general missing: social dimension, material dimension, financial. Another point is the assumption typically of very high energy potentials, both for renewable and non-renewable. Then there is a neglect of the metabolic implications of future energy investments, which can also be stated as, well, issues as ROI, net energy, are just not taken into account, not looked at in these models. As I mentioned, address the challenges of 100% renewable system. Well, and then all the issue of linkages, which I already mentioned. Okay, so how do we deal in WILIAM in particular with these limitations, no? So, for example, in terms of economy, we have developed a very detailed economic module, which has different submodules, which are also very detailed. So we have consumption submodule, which, for example, includes 60 household types in the European Union countries. Production, which is based on input-output tables of 62 sectors, government, investment, labor, international trade, financial dimensions. So here maybe something important to note is that for us, and in reality, GDP is totally endogenous. While, for example, in typical IPCC models, GDP is exogenous. But this is basically because we are trying to answer different questions. The IPCC models, IMAGE, GCAM, and so on, they try to answer the question, what is the technological mix to be able to mitigate greenhouse gas emissions, being able to supply a certain amount of GDP growth, and an exogenous population evolution consistent with United Nations projections, no? So this is why the scope is different. Of course, IPCC is coming from United Nations process, and well, they have institutional constraints. So this simplistic representation of economic processes in YAMs, of course, limits the linkage with other dimensions, no? So here in WILIAM, we are able, I will show you later, we are able to capture several important linkages between energy, economy, and materials. So basically, the changes in the physical bottom-up models, for example, energy transformation, transport, material extraction, affect the economic model, and vice versa in the other way around through feedbacks. We are also modeling economic climate change impacts, which is also different from IPCC models, which focus mainly on mitigation, or traditionally have focused more on mitigation. So we have modules for demography, society, and materials. In terms of very high energy potentials, so, well, I already mentioned, no, for oil and for fossil fuels in general and metals, there are geological constraints, harder geological constraints that cannot be overcome with the typical thinking of increased supply, more discoveries, more availability. There are hard constraints. In terms of renewables, we have estimated in the project techno-sustainable potentials for the main renewables, considering biophysical, geographical, natural resources, and ROI constraints. And then, also very important, and this is one of the benefits also of integration, when you integrate submodules, you have exogenous assumptions in typical specific models. For example, in energy models, the potential of bioenergy is usually exogenous data, exogenous parameter, because you don't have land use representation. But in this model, the potential of renewables, in this case, which depend on land use, solar and bioenergy, totally dependent on land use module. So you have scenarios in land use module which allow for this expansion of bioenergy and solar, there will be no problem, but then we will account for the consequences of this, no? So this is fully endogenized. This ROI of the full system, which was one of the novelties of Medeas, is one of the things we are still working on it, but the idea is to be able to feedback these implications of reduction or variation of ROI during the transition to the rest of the system. And last point, I mentioned, no, that many YAMs are not able to reach 100% renewables. So here we have a methodological problem, because YAMs in general, and WILIAM also in particular, has a frequency of 1 year. This means that we simulate, for example, now we are 2023, next time that we simulate is 2024, 25, we go year by year. This means that everything that has a subannual frequency, we don't see it. So we have developed a specific methodology, which will be explained in the day you see the energy module, to try to bring subannual time scale effects of energy variability, because renewables are varying along the year, to bring this information into the model. And then additionally, this is something that it was not intended in the proposal, but because you have to take in mind this project started before COVID. So then there was, of course, the COVID, the lockdown, and there was the new European policies, the new push for hydrogen. So we thought that, well, since it's so much important European policy, we should also have a representation of hydrogen, which of course, for just those of you who know, you know, is complex. So it has been a lot of work. Okay, so this in terms of, let's say, WILIAM novelties, differentiation with relation to the state of the art. So some general characteristics. I already mentioned that the time resolution is 1 year. The regional scope is very important. So this is, in fact, one of the improvements from Medeas. Medeas was global. Well, we have three levels, but here, what we have is a multi-regional, all the regions evolve at the same time. For all models, all modules, we have 9 regions. And in some modules, we have the EU disaggregated in the 27 countries. So here you have a picture, you can have more or less an idea. I must say that the split, the regional split, has been chosen due to economic constraint, economic data constraint. So in relation to the input output and so on. So these questions you should ask in the day they cover the economic module, but basically that's the reason, for example, in South America, instead of having one full region for South America or Latin America, we have some countries belonging to what we call Latin America and others in purple, which belong to rest of the world. Which this, of course, makes sense from economic point of view, but creates problems in the physical modules, for example, land use and so on. Well, in terms of methods, we are many different teams working with different methods. For example, I mentioned input-output. We are working with life cycle analysis, econometric analysis. We are bringing everything into system dynamics framework, which is not always obvious, but we are trying. And then we have the maybe the biggest issue or the biggest complexity, which was mentioned before, I should highlight, is the consistency between the monetary and physical dimension. So you have to take into account that in a model like this, you have the same thing many times in two parts of the model. And these two things should evolve, of course, coherently. I'm going to give you an example. So in the economy module, there is some a consumption of electricity of equivalent to, I don't know, $100. This is mirrored by a consumption in kilowatt hours in the energy module. And the evolution of this expenditure for energy and the evolution of this consumption in physical units in kilowatt hours should go hand in hand. And this is complex. I mentioned that this is a policy simulation model. We are not trying to optimize anything. We think that in the world, the world does not work optimizing. So we think it's more realistic. In terms of size of the model, well, this is related to the question of computational time, no? The model is very large. You have a lot of modules, multi-regional, and the interlinkages and so on. So it's around 7,000 symbols, around 1 gigabyte of data. And as I mentioned, depending on the computer, if you have compiled the model, can be 2-3 minutes, which is workable. Well, modular structure. This is something very important from development and from also usability point of view, because as this is also related with one question that came before, no? Of course, everybody comes with expertise in one or two fields, but it's difficult that you find one person having expertise in all the topics of the model, no? So we have made an effort to structure the model. And what is this modular structure? So, of course, all the model is interconnected, but there are some central dimensions which we group together, and this is what we call the economy module or the energy module. And this is mainly a conceptual division to structure the model and to structure its usability. So, for example, when you want to do scenarios, but you only want to change inputs from economy, then you have all of them identified. No? Of course, we had to set up a coordinated and distributed programming through GitLab platform. And this modular structure also was very helpful, not only for developing, but for validating and so on. Well, coming back here to the open source, we also have accessible documentation. I will show you later. Yes. So I have here three main deliverables, which are already in our website, which if you want to take a look to, because of course it's 2020 project, produces a lot of material, but in the sense that we are finishing the project in less than 1 month, these are the, I will say, the main takeaways of the project. The first deliverable here on the left, deliverable 8.4, is about the policy recommendations. So even if the full model is not totally finished, there are significant parts which are working well, and we use them for producing these recommendations. Then this deliverable in the middle is about a synthesis of the model and selected results of all modules. And then we have here on the right, the Python translation for those interested on that, and the handbook, which is, let's say, a documentation of the model, quite in detail. I think we reach a good equilibrio or a good balance between detail and length. So we have, I don't know if I remember well, 100 or 120 pages of model documentation, which is quite synthetic for a model of this size. Okay, so I continue with an overview of WILIAM modules. Here I'm going to be a bit fast because the next two sessions of the MOOC are focused on a detailed description of this module. So my idea is just to give a brief overview, and then of course a specific question and so on is better that you ask on the following session. So basically in demography, we wanted to capture the effect of the evolution of population, taking into account regional, sex, and age variation, no? So we have representation of birth and deaths, And we have a representation also of immigration, which is an exogenous policy or well, hypothesis when you run the model. And then we need to know the evolution of the composition of households. I mentioned 60 households for the European Union, how this composition of households is going to evolve in the future. So in economy, as I mentioned, we have a lot of dimensions represented there. We have labor, we have jobs, we have wages, we have international trade, public policies, different consumption in different regions. So here, there is a loop diagram of the relationships between the submodules of the economic model, but now I'm not going to delve into these details to be more synthetic, because I prefer to focus in my presentation later on the intermodule linkages among the linkages between modules. So, well, basically it's a complex model representing many dimensions. Maybe some things to say. As I said, it's not simulation model, agents do not optimize. Economic growth is driven by exogenous and capital labor productivity and endogenous energy intensity, labor force and resources availability, and markets are not generally cleared by the price mechanism, which, as you can see, is also quite heterodox from an economic point of view. From the point of view of the environment modules, land, water, and climate, well, of course, we have a representation of greenhouse gas emissions from deforestation and livestock, which translated to climate change impacts, temperature change, sea level rise, and so on. And here I would like to highlight two novelties with relation to the state of the art, is the detailed representation of food and diets and nutrients that we have, and also the interlinkages with between renewables and land use, no, solar and these biofuels in these pictures. So, as I said, well, you have here many submodules. You will see this in detail on the day you cover this module. Well, for materials, we have geological constraints for fossil fuels, for materials. We have the material requirements of new technologies, green technologies, if you want, for low carbon generation, no? And here you have to be aware that the new green technologies are very material intensive, as I explained and showed in the first example about silver and PV. So here you see some basements of enormous windmills, and here you see the battery of electric car, which is invisible to user, but it can be from 200 to 300 kilos of metals. So basically, we have, in materials, supply-demand dynamics of four base metals, aluminium, copper, nickel, and iron, which is fully integrated with the economic module. Then we have the supply-demand dynamics of fossil fuels, also integrated with the economy through the energy module. Then we have a representation of the bottom-up requirements of 22 types of potentially critical minerals for the main green energy technologies, solar, wind, and electric vehicle batteries. And lastly, we have uranium, no? So here, I don't enter into details. There is a lot of feedbacks here, modules involved. My colleagues will explain this in more detail. In terms of energy, well, the same, no? We have refineries, we have oil extraction, photovoltaic, we have the variability of the supply, we have the potentials, sustainable potential. So we put all these elements in the energy module, which has a part of energy end use. So what the users use in terms of electricity, heat, diesel, gasoline. Then we have the chain of energy transformation, where to supply this final energy consumed by final users, we need some primary energy, can be hydrocarbons, it can be renewables. We see from the energy mix, the greenhouse gas emissions. We have some intelligence to forecast or to predict, depending on assumptions, what will be the future energy capacities installed. And here, of course, biophysical constraints, renewable potentials I already mentioned, indicators such as the ROI or the SOI of the system, And we have one full module for this variability management of renewables. So this will be explained again in more detail, but to give you a flavor, no? In this figure, you have in green the inputs from other modules, in red, the main outputs of this module, and then in yellow, the scenario assumption. So you can see there is a lot of interlinkage. For society, well, society is a module which basically translates what is happening in the full model into social relevant and more comprehensive information. So we have indicators of inequality, such as Gini between countries. We have a representation of education, stylized, and we compute the HDI, evolution of the HDI by country. Okay, for now, fun part also here. So imagine now we have all these modules, and then these modules, with their complexity, internal complexity, they interact with the rest of the modules, no? So here I'm going to show you which are the links which are already present in WILIAM, which are working. And then I will show you some links that we are working on them. So, well, first thing, of course, everything is interlinked. I decide to start by here, maybe simpler. No, the economy module receives inputs from demography in terms of population, needs to know the working age population and what is the household composition. If there are more young people, more old people, more people with kids, the consumption of each household is very different. Then there is the link with finance to know, on the one hand, the household's wealth, because at the end the consumption is not only income, it's wealth. And then you have things such as government debt, interest, and so on, which affects the decisions of government module. Then economy sends a lot of information to energy, ask for a transport economic demand for passengers, sends how much energy is required to produce for each 62 of the 62 sectors by type of final energy, the amount of investment, the amount of CO2 prices if there is a policy, the primary energy prices. At the moment, energy is only sending information about transport, but as I will show you later, we are working on many feedbacks work going from energy to economy. Then land and water has three inputs, from main inputs from three modules, population, GDP, and the demand of solar land and bioenergy. And then to energy gives back information about how much available land for solar and bioenergy potential. Then materials also receives a lot of inputs from other modules, for example, from economy, what is the mining, the demand to mine copper, nickel, aluminium, and iron, the ones for which we have a explicit sector in the input-output. And then we also have the hydrocarbons demand coming from energy. And then to compute the bottom-up material requirements of the green technologies, we send the capacities information to materials. So materials interact with economy, which is the mineral and hydrocarbon prices, and this enters into economy, and then the prices has many impacts in all the module. To energy, we send back inputs about mineral scarcity and embodied energy materials, which allows us to compute ROIs and SOIs also. Okay, inputs to climate. Two main inputs. Here we are capturing the main sources of greenhouse gas emissions. On the one hand, energy and the industrial processes. On the other hand, the agriculture and land use change emissions. At the moment, climate is only feedback into land and water through a reduction of the cropland due to sea level rise, but we have more impacts ongoing now. And at the end, I let society, as I mentioned, society is a module where we compute these indicators, no? So it takes information from the rest of the model and computes these indicators, Gini, education, and HDI. Okay, so even if the model is not finish, we already have a complex here figure, no? Even more complex is this one, which we call simplifying. It's not a joke, even if it looks like. This is a figure already. This is a loop diagram, which is, in fact, we are improving and completing each time we improve something in the model, in which you can see, I know you cannot see the details, but each color represents a module. The black arrows represent links inside the module, so the main links, because I mentioned there are 7,000 symbols here, there are probably no more than 100. And then all the green arrows are links between modules that are already validated. Okay, so here, well, I don't have so much time. I wanted to show you some loops that you can here identify, but because this is the purpose of this type of diagrams, to understand your model, no? But basically, well, if you follow the sense of the arrows, you can see causal loop change. And here is the same figure, marking in red feedbacks on which we are working currently, and let's say that we are quite close of having them, no? Of course, you could think of always in this type of models of more feedbacks. So these ones are on their work. We are thinking about introducing financial constraints in the decision of households to buy new vehicles, to send back to economy from energy, which is the energy production structure and the energy investments, to endogenize this in energy, to have climate change impacts in economy and land water, etc. Okay, so as I mentioned, William is modeling development. Project finishes now in at the end of November. So we will release, let's say, a version at the end of the project. It probably will be at the end of November, beginning of December. So I suggest that you check, well, because the MOOC is, I don't know which when is the last day, but well, check the, you can say the, check the website or subscribe to the newsletter, and then you will receive an email when this is available. So it will be a beta version, and then we will explain in the release what is the exact state of the model. Okay, so how William Invention looks like, no? I wanted to share you a bit so it's not so abstract. So basically you have a folder in which you have a MDL, which is the, this is the code, I mean the code, yes, because of course you have a graphic representation, but here if you click in edit view code, you will have all the lines of the code. And then you have three folders in which we store, as Luis Javier mentioned, for example, in scenario parameters. Well, maybe I should switch, a ver. So this is the, okay. Do you see my folder? My Explorer?
Yes, yes.
It's okay, clear. So for example, if you want to, all the model parameters for each module are stored here. So we have one folder for each module. Then we have a couple of extras which are common to everybody. But for example, I don't know, you enter into energy. Of course, depending on the complexity of the model, of the module, sorry, some modules have a lot of data, others have less, others have enormous data. So for example, in energy, we have all these extras currently. If we go to economy, because it has the 35 regions and the input output and so on, the amount of data is much higher. Okay, so here you can check all the model. There is no number in principle hanging on in the code. All, everything is here. And then if you want just to do a simulation of a scenario, just use the model. We have this scenario parameters file, which has one tab per module. So I know again, it's very small, but it's just to give you a flavor. So for example, if you want to change, well, here we have a tab with all the policies ordered by module. And then if it works well, yes, you have direct links to the parametrization. And then if you want to do a policy, you need to read the comment, no, in Benzim to know exactly what to do. Another Excel, which is quite important, I have insisted a lot into the modularization, no? We have an Excel of switches which control control the intermodule linkage. So if you want, for example, run energy module isolated from the rest of the model, this is quite easy to do, changing one number here. Or if you want to deactivate one feedback to see what is the value added or the impact of having this feedback or not having it, you can do that. No? So this is this increases a lot the usability of the model and to understand the model. So in Benzin, for those of you who are not familiar, basically we have here many views. So we have the modularization also here in the views. The first word of the name of the view is the module, then is the submodule. And here, well, I don't know, you can go wherever you prefer. This is transport of passengers. And of course, each module, I mean, each view has its complexity, but we have tried to organize as good as possible the model. Okay, so coming back to my presentation, yes, I'm finishing the presentation. So I just wanted to show you the next session. So if you take this diagram, the next day, on 6th November, you will cover all these modules, land and water, energy, materials, and climate. It's a lot, but we need to be synthetic. And then on the third day, will be covered economy, finance, society, and demography, which you can see that they are, let's say, a bit, the amount is a bit lower. And then the last day will be dedicated to, once you understand the main ideas of the whole thing, how to run some policies and scenarios. So I'm done. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, Iñigo. It was great, the presentation. So I think we have many questions. So okay, let's start. I mean, so José, please go ahead.
Thank you very much, Iñigo, for the presentation. No, my question, I had put it on the chat, and you showed some estimates for the rebound effect, and I was curious if that was from the WILIAM model or if it is there from some other module, if you could point us to.
Yes, no, they are from colleagues. Are you still seeing my presentation?
No.
Not anymore. The references are in the PowerPoint, and because the PowerPoint will be public, it's just some studies which concluded that, which showed us with the empirical method.
Okay, thanks. So all the presentations are already in the drive that you receive for the presentation today.
So quickly.
Okay, sorry. Okay, there was Nigel.
Yes, hi. Thanks very much for that presentation about William. Very interesting. My question is about doing more detailed modeling at, kind of regional level. I mean, in particular, I'm interested in modeling the energy transition for the Orkney Islands in north of Scotland. I'm wondering if you think that kind of embedding that in something like William would be useful, or whether it would be better just to, build my own model.
Uh-huh. Well, it's a very good question. This model has a global scope and is trying to get the main interactions between the big regions. So in our group, what we do is we develop specific local models for specific local cases in that case. And then, of course, some of the exogenous inputs from these local models are coming from a simulation of Medeas or a simulation of William, no? For example, I don't know, global temperature change. But so the important thing is that you need to have a narrative for the global model, and then a narrative which has not to be the same, because of course, locally and globally is two different things. A local narrative which takes into account the constraints or the world as a boundary condition as defined by the outputs of Medeas or William.
Okay, thanks.
We have some projects in which we are doing that. If you are interested, we will exchange more.
Okay, I'll probably try emailing you. Thank you.
Okay. So just to say that in the previous question here, you have the this works from Broadway and Freire, and you have references in the PowerPoint somewhere.
Thanks, Inigo. And Leo, please.
Yeah, so thanks for the work that you've done for it, developing this great model. I have two questions. You can maybe choose which you want to answer. The first question is, the project is ending by the year. How is the development going further? What are we going to see? And the second question is, how's the development of the different modules going so far? Is there modules that you would say are working like totally independent and working just fine? And so are there some interlinkages where we have to be careful in using it right now because it's still in the development phase?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we still haven't decided at consortia level what will be the exact strategy when the project finishes. So now we are, let's say, very stressed with the end of project deliverables, make as better as possible model, disseminate, et cetera, et cetera. So we need to take some time and we will set up this. And what I can say is that, of course, there will be a continuation using WILIAM because we have been 4 years and a half developing the model, and now is when we can start the exploitation. So while we do, let's say, papers or research or whatever, we will find issues and we will continue producing updated versions of WILIAM, no, for sure during the next year. In terms of the state of the current model, well, I will say that the modules, let me put, independently, in general, work okay. Of course, there are always issues, but in general, the it's okay. And now what we are doing is to try to introduce more linkages. No, is this the last slide that I showed? This one, because we think that even if the module isolated works well, we think that we are missing some important feedbacks that will change the behavior of the model. So this is the current state. So how much of this will make it into the release version in December is a question I cannot answer because we still have 1 month. And well, I must also say that it was funny to see the video at the beginning for those of you who were connected early, because you know that this video we did during COVID lockdown, so it's for that everybody is at home. No, and there were some videos from like a workshop, so this video is not real. We could not meet for 1 year and a half to do the workshop. No, what I want to say is that in 1 month or 2 months of work, we can now do a lot of things.
Timo, please.
Yes, thank you so much. Super interesting. I just wanted to hear a little bit about the calibration of the model with historical data when it's such a complex and broad model.
Uh-huh. It's a very good question. So the method to develop the model has been first, of course, there is a general coordination and a general idea, but first each module works, let's say, by itself to develop the basic structure. And of course, the coordination, as I said, never stopped, ensuring always that when you have all the modules finished, that they can communicate between themselves. But what I want to say is that different modules did that in different ways. So for example, and also it depends a lot on the data constraints. I'm going to give you an example. For energy and land use modules, it was possible to find historical data for most of the important dimensions, no? So it could be possible to have time series and to do some regression or whatever. But for example, for economy, which is a very specific module, we only have all data for 1 year, which is the year 2015. So this has constrained that at the end, the WILIAM model does not have a full historic period of reproducing of historical data for all the variables, because lack of data lacking in economic model. So at the end of the day, we have a baseline year for 2015, some modules which are able to reproduce past trends quite nicely, and other parts not possible. So this is a very fast question, and then I invite you to ask in each session, each module, how they have calibrated the module.
Yeah, especially for the economy, there was some issue about microdata and the multi-regional input-output that constrained a lot the availability of data. Okay, any other comment or question